Vibers, it's your boy Kai, and welcome to Kai Watches Gilmore Girls, where I'm documenting my first watch of the TV show Gilmore Girls. It's time for us to review Season 5, Episode 14 of the show, which is entitled Say Something, which originally aired February 15th, 2005 on the WB. Do you remember the WB? Not many people remember, but I remember. You know why? Because I'm old. In this episode, Lorelai begs Luke to forgive her. Lorelai is frantic after the disastrous scene at Richard and Emily's vow renewal wedding thing, and begs Luke to not give up on their relationship. However, Luke's decision that he needs time alone leaves Lorelai devastated. Stranded at Yale without her car, Rory is so worried. You see that? Rory is so worried about Lorelai's depressed state that she borrows Logan's limo and driver and heads home to Stars Hollow to care for her mom. Meanwhile, Taylor is my least favorite character in the show, and he has the whole town taking sides on the relationship and breakup between Lorelai and Luke. I honestly believe that Taylor might be the true antagonist of the show, but we'll get into that a little bit later. So did this episode deliver after a fantastic 100th episode? Let's find out as I recap the episode for my favorite moments, my least favorite moments, fun episode facts, and of course, my episode vibe score. Be sure to subscribe and to hit that notification bell for weekly videos that are aimed to make your day just a little bit better. And follow me on your favorite social media platforms, where I'm always posting things that'll help you do good, feel good, be good, and live a good life full of good vibes. Let's take a look at Season 5, Episode 14 of Gilmore Girls. Let's start off with my favorite moments. Number 1, Lorelai and Rory supporting each other. It's episodes like this that remind me why so many mothers watch this show with their daughters. Instead of getting mad at each other in this episode, Lorelai and Rory prove to be each other's most valuable asset. In the beginning of this episode, we have Lorelai not getting upset at Rory after she got caught making out with Logan at the wedding. I'm sure Rory thought that Lorelai was surely going to get upset, but surprisingly, she wasn't. Let the record show, by the way, that Rory pulling that off at her grandfather's and grandmother's wedding, that's a flex, and we all know it. You see what happens? You jump off of one sort of unsafe piece of scaffolding in front of a bunch of people who don't use the letter E in their sentences, and all of a sudden, you're the boldest person in the show. I envy you, Rory Gilmore. Lorelai not getting mad at Rory also says a lot given the drama that Lorelai had to deal with between Christopher and Luke in the previous episode. Most importantly, after Luke breaks up with Lorelai, Rory drops everything to make sure that her mom is okay. She didn't have a car, of course, so Logan sent his trusty driver, Frank, to drive her around. More on that later. Number 2, Kirk and the Dance Dance Revolution. How could I not give Kirk a shout out here? Last month, I actually played Dance Dance Revolution for the first time at a Dave & Buster's. It's the first time I ever did it, I mean, I guess since middle school. And let me tell you, I ended up being just as sweaty, if not more sweaty, than Kirk. I got the high score of the day, just to let you know. I got the high score before passing out while reaching for my inhaler, but I got the high score. So take that, little Timmy. I beat your score. Also, little Timmy, I apologize for screaming, "I am a dancing god!" right in your face after I got the high score. Look, little Timmy, I take my Dance Dance Revolution very seriously. Number 3, Suki consoling Lorelai. Suki, in an effort to console Lorelai, tells an awkward story, sponsored by Katie Kilik, about a couple who are separated for over 40 years before ending up together to live happily ever after. Of course, this fails and only freaks out Lorelai even more. As a result, Suki makes up another story on the spot about a couple who were only separated for a week and ended up living happily ever after. Of course, this story was a lie, but as she was telling the story, all I can think of was, man, we all need a Suki in our lives, don't we? Number 4, Rory and Logan communicating. Rory and Logan did something in this episode that I rarely saw happen with Dean and Jess. They communicated their feelings. How adorable is that? I can already hear you typing, "Kai is Team Logan." Well, hold your horses. I'm not fully on the Logan train yet. I love how he listens to Rory as she communicates her disappointment when she realized that she wasn't hanging out with him alone. Instead of brooding like Dean or running away toward a failed spinoff like Jess, Logan not only listens, but he reflects and offers suggestions for how the situation can be avoided in the future. You're playing with my feels, Logan. and I don't know how to feel about that yet. Number 5, the dream sequence. Dream sequences in a TV show can be hit or miss, but it was effectively used in this episode. I just wish they would use it a little bit more. As the viewer, we've been caught in one of Lorelai's dreams about maybe once or twice per season, and I wish that they would use that device even more because it is effective. There is no one else's dreams that I want to see in this show other than Lorelai's. Okay, that's a lie. We all want to see Kirk's dreams. Like, why would we not want to see Kirk's dreams? Number 6, Lauren Graham's acting in this episode. Lauren Graham excels in this show when we get to see her extend beyond her witty dialogue, which is something we get probably 90% of the time. But when she's allowed to go to a dark place, when she's confused or scared or angry, she never ever lets me down. I loved her acting while she's trying to leave Luke a voicemail message. I actually ended up watching it twice just to see all of the subtle acting choices that she made, such as her struggling to find the right words to say or not being able to catch her breath as she's speaking. It was great to watch, and I wish they allowed her to do more of that because it's fantastic. Okay, those were my favorite moments. What about my least favorite moments from the episode? Well, we'll start off with number 1, Michelle and the dolls. Is it me, or has Michelle been reduced to nothing but negative energy this season? More so than he ever was in previous seasons. Yes, Michelle is known for his knee-jerk reactions and disliking good customer service, but this season seems to take it to another level, and it's kind of getting a little old to me. I'll be honest. Every time I see Michelle in season 5, all I can think to myself is, if you hate this job so much and what it entails, aka customer service, why do you stay? I get it. He works with his friends Lorelai and Suki, but I'm surprised they allow him to get away with what he does to the customers and around the place. My biggest fear for Michelle as a character is that he's not really being fleshed out at the moment. He's become more of a caricature in season 5, which is slightly disappointing, seeing as he's the show's only recurring character that's a person of color. Number 2, Taylor. Well. My least favorite character in the show makes a return in this episode, and he continues to annoy me. Shout out to the actor playing him, but good lord, that character annoys me. In this episode, he promotes Luke and Lorelai's breakup by having the town choose a side, mainly so they could be judged based on whose side they're on. One episode after I made a big speech about how Richard and Emily were the antagonists of the show, and Taylor waltzes into this episode and says, hey, hold my beer. Number 3, Luke and Lorelai break up. Let me preface this by saying that this was one of my least favorite moments from the episode for no other reason than the fact that I just want to see them together. I mean, come on, it's Luke and Lorelai. They should be together. But with that being said, I totally get why Luke is in his feels and ends the relationship despite what we, as the viewer, want. For a moment, I want you to put yourself in Luke's shoes. Richard and Emily have always looked down on Luke. Richard doesn't think Luke is running his business well. Emily doesn't even think Luke's business is a legitimate business or a means of living at all. They don't even notice Luke when he's there at their wedding and they obnoxiously mock his suits. Emily literally tries to end his relationship with Lorelai by plotting for Christopher to come steal Lorelai away. Lorelai didn't tell Luke about her getting drunk with Christopher. And most importantly, the Gilmores represented everything that he hates in society. Remember all of the rants that Luke used to do in season 1 about the upper class? Yeah, don't forget that. Most of that stuff could easily be applied to the Gilmores. With that said, while I'm sad Luke and Lorelai broke up, I understand why it happened. Luke, if you're feeling down, buddy, don't feel bad. It's okay. Come on over to my place. We'll have a beer, and then we'll cry about how we're both in love with season 5 Lorelai. Okay, those were my favorite and least favorite moments from the episode. Let's talk about some facts about the episode. Starting with My Man Godfrey. The movie that Luke is watching when Lorelai finds him at the theater is a movie called My Man Godfrey, a 1936 American screwball comedy film directed by Gregory LaCava and starring William Powell and Carol Lombard. The story concerns a socialite who hires a derelict to be her family's butler and then falls in love with him. In 1999, the original version of My Man Godfrey was deemed culturally significant by the United States Library of Congress and selected for preservation in the National Film Registry. The film was remade in 1957 with June Allison and David Niven in the starring roles. Dana Davis. As always, I like to highlight people of color who are featured in Gilmore Girl episodes. We don't get to see a lot of them in this show, so I always make it a point to give them a shout out. We'll start with Dana Davis, the young black actress that plays Althea in the scene with Rory and Paris. Dana Davis is an American actress and novelist known for playing Monica Dawson on the NBC series Heroes, Chastity Church in the ABC Family television series 10 Things I Hate About You, and Carmen Phillips in the TNT series Franklin and Bash. Davis was born in Davenport, Iowa, and attended Davenport North High School. She is a skilled violinist and attended Loyola Marymount University, where she earned her bachelor's degree in music in 2006. Davis appeared alongside teen actress Hilary Duff in Raise Your Voice. She has also appeared in Veronica Mars, That's So Raven, The O.C., Point Pleasant, Pushing Daisies, and Hidden Palms. Davis is the author of Tiffany Sly Lives Here Now, a contemporary young adult novel published by Harlequin Books in April 2018. Her second novel, The Voice in My Head, was published by HarperCollins and released on May 28, 2019. She uses Dana L. Davis as her pen name while retaining Dana Davis for her acting roles. Dale E. Turner. Dale E. Turner is the actor that plays limo driver Frank in this episode. Dale is the executive producer, writer, and title character of the award-winning short film My Name is Lamar. His other film credits include HBO's All the Way, Electric Slide, The Marshmallow Mystery Tour, Intolerable Cruelty, Real Women Have Curves, This Christmas, Loner, Teddy Bear's Picnic, Wedding Day, Darini, Gabi and God, and Bloody Wednesday. Dale was honored to be on the 2010 Primetime Emmy ballot for Outstanding Guest Actor in a Comedy and Drama Series for Modern Family and House. Dale has over 90 national commercials to his credit, including one spot with the United States Army that earned him an Advertising Age magazine's Best Commercial Actor Award in 2004. As a vocalist, Dale was a lead singer and percussionist for the R&B band Upside the Head. He has sang in recording sessions as well as in concerts with Chris Brown, Poison, Barry Manilow, Helen Reddy, gospel artist Tremaine Hawkins, John P. Key, Kurt Carr, and was a member of the gospel group The Ricky Grundy Chorale. Dale is a quarterfinalist for both Final Drafts and ScreenCraft screenwriting contests with his romantic thriller Chalkline. His other screenplays include Mr. Cotton, Nice Guys Finish Lonely, and is adapting a Frank Capra holiday classic, Pocketful of Miracles. For television, he has written Theme Park, a workplace situational comedy. Okay, so with all that being said, what did I think of this episode? Well, I give it a 5 out of 10. Slightly disappointing of a follow-up to an explosive season 5, episode 13, but it's kept afloat by the drama between Luke and Lorelai. Otherwise, it would probably receive a lower score. Not my favorite episode, but it is par for the course, which isn't a bad thing. I'll take an average episode over a painfully boring episode. So there you have it, Vibers, my recap for Season 5, Episode 14 of Gilmore Girls. What do you all think of this episode? Let me know in the comments below. Thank you for watching, and until next time, God bless and good vibes.